questions, maybe I can ask the three presenters to take a seat here. And then we make it a bit of a panel setup. After the questions, you get the fourth presentation of this morning. I already saw a few hands raised. Yes, you over there, please.
Wilma Mossink. Actually, I have a question for all the speakers. Where do you see the role of the universities in this? Will it be just like in the past, universities buying the articles? Universities are working on repositories, next generations, where they try to build all these features and try to innovate the ways of scholarly communications. Is there a way where they connect with publishers, and how would you like, how would you see their role?
Who wants to go first?
Type of things that go into repositories to be able to link out from our publications. It should be found. Yes. It should be able to be found, and having it available in a public database and pointed out to would be a great way of achieving that.
Ah.
Testing 1, 2, 3. Can you hear me? I think in some ways the roles won't change in the sense that a lot of the features that I think we're all building out, they overlay the sort of the standard way of interacting with information. So, you know, universities will continue to use, let's say, articles. Those articles may have additional bells and whistles built in, but I would imagine the fundamental relationship would still remain the same, because it's the researchers working within the universities that will continue to use these features. So I think at one level, I'm not sure there will be a huge change. But then, I mean, repositories is probably a whole different discussion there. They're clearly growing in importance, and it may well be some of the ideas we developed, especially I think around working methods and community curation, could find their way into processes for using and developing repositories.
Of course, there's always the risk of duplication of what's being said. I see that the scientific publishing, you have the formal publication process, and that's one part in the communication between scientists. And there's so much more coming, and arising. There's the communities, there's the data set repositories, and I think that the universities do also play indeed a large role in those second part of the communication, that other part of the communication process. And for us, for the Elsevier, and for the publishers, I think it's crucial to work with all those other players in the other forms of scientific communication, that we link to each other, that we communicate with each other, and that we indeed collaborate on all aspects of the communication. So there's definitely a role for university, and I think it's for universities. I think it's important that we communicate together to how to integrate the different forms of communication that we have.
More questions? Yes, there in the back, Thijs Willems. Can you introduce yourself, please?
Hello, Michiel Thijs from Brill Publishers. It's, I guess, very comforting that we're not up for a paradigm shift, as other speakers have presented in the past days, but rather an addition of existing tools and new technologies adding to the concept of the article as we know it. My question here is, could anyone, perhaps the two speakers on the left, elaborate on archiving and preservation of all these extra bells and whistles?
Yeah, I, That's indeed a question that we often ask ourselves as well. Like, if we have all those different forms of modern technologies and modern interaction, and maybe even interaction that actually is a live thing that you cannot easily archive, how to deal with it? It's in part still an open question that we don't have an answer for. So as long as we haven't answered that question in full, we always foresee, sorry, as long as we don't have answered that question in full, we foresee that we have to use a separate version of the article next to the interactive, the multimedia version, which is really an archivable version, the PDF, or maybe the successor of the PDF, but something that is archivable in one way or the other. So I think the question is yet unanswered, but we are definitely aware of the issue here.
And yes, I'll just say it's definitely a thing of separating the data from the application side. So the data, we all have that as XML, and we have the compounds are in there. The additional semantic data is actually really easy to keep. What's difficult, as we've just said, is the interactions and the applications around that, because that's just going to evolve.
Yeah, there's a question all the way there in the back there after. No. Oh, well. Okay, fine. Go ahead.
I'm Herbert Guttermeyer from InisCNRS. I have a question on this notion of supplementary data, extra content, and mainly to the first speaker, because I think you ended your presentation with an example from the earth sciences, where the supplementary data was given by linking to data sets. I think it's primary research data, observational data, something like that. And I want to know in what sense this kind of supplementary data, which is obviously an example with out of this Article of the Future project, differs from the extra content that you mentioned in your presentation before.
Yeah, I think it's a good question, because I realized later that I maybe hadn't made that clear in the presentation. Most of the content in the article of the first Article of the Future prototype was contained and submitted by the author. In the last slide, the earth science, the Pangea linking, we really talk about data sets that are external to the article. So the author did not submit that extra data. It might be a gigabyte of data in all sort of observations, a real data set, and it's not stored with the article, it's not stored with the publisher, but the user or the author has submitted and stored it somewhere else in an external data repository. And we as Elsevier, we really want to connect those things, because we think that it would add value for the user and for the researcher, that there is a real discoverability from the article to the data set and from the data set to the article. So we really need that interlinking. So yeah, it's external data. We don't have it, we don't touch it, but we really want to link to it.
Okay, thank you. There's a question all the way in the back. Thank you. Okay, please introduce.
I'm Kaveh from River Valley Technologies. I was interested in some of the things in the Article of the Future, specifically that 3 or 4 bullet points saying the summary, the very basic summary of the paper. Wouldn't it be nice to have that in every paper, even if it's printed? Because you don't have to have that, it simply have it at the top. I think it would force authors to write more understandable text. So why not just have it in print as well?
Thank you.
Yeah, we see that this is something that is highly appreciated by our authors. We first introduce it in will introduce it in the in electronic version, and if the pickup by the authors is really really very very good, then we have to consider that. It's indeed a question that is raised and internally as well. Should we also put it in the print article if we really think it's important? We have to investigate that. Yes. So it's a question that we have asked ourselves as well. So and the answer is yet or no.
Okay, there's a question here. Noel, over here. Yeah.
name is Noel Verhagen. I'm the university librarian at the University of Amsterdam. Well, my question is especially for Mr. Abelsberg. Will the article of the future also influence the article of the past? I mean, some of the functionalities that are developed or are going to be developed for the article of the future could quite easily, I think, be applied on articles of the past as well, and to enrich, let's say, articles that have been appeared maybe some long time ago, adding to the complexity, of course, of the archival issue. So what would then the new version of that article be? Would the Royal Library in the Netherlands refresh its e-depot with all these new appearances of old articles?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think that some of the features are indeed features that can be implemented technology-wise, and then also will apply automatically on the on the pre-existing articles, the HTML versions of those, for example, the reflect type of semantic markup, the tabbed view, but then basically on past articles, the tabbed view will be less rich than if we really recreate the new articles. For the archival, I don't think that that's going to change, because the authoritative copy at the end will, at least that's how I see it for the near future, will still be the PDF version. And that's for now the authoritative copy. Basically, the article of the future at this moment is really to improve the efficiency of the researcher in accessing the article, in reading the article, in skimming the article, in quickly determining whether it's relevant or not. But for the archival and for the formal referencing, we still stick to the PDF for the moment.
Okay, I have time for one last question. Then I take the liberty myself for all three of you, because I think in the essence is that it's all about the user. And you've all mentioned something about the user, but the sort of the message underneath was that it's not so easy to get the users on board for stuff like this. Does that mean that you still haven't found the right format or the right presentation, and you still need to develop these new features further? Or should the user be educated? Do you have a certain point on that? And if the user needs to be educated, how to do that? Perhaps we can do it from this way.
And it's a very good question. I think it's actually a bit of both. Because if you think of the internet as a whole, before the days of Google and browsing online, could any user, well, there probably wasn't even users in those days, could anyone have predicted the features they wanted? Well, probably not. But once somebody brought those features out to the public domain, they can then invite feedback and actually set up, a feedback loop. So I think it's partly an experimental process on the part of the publisher, but then it's connecting that with the end user, allowing them to feedback, and we will learn off each other.
Richard? Yeah, it's trying things out, really, and see what sticks. I hope that an overall semi-standard will emerge, just so it's easier for the end user to actually go into different places and see things in the same form. You hope that will evolve by an evolutionary process by which the things that people like will be taken on by everyone. But it's a difficult process, and it's a long one, and I don't think we're anywhere near there yet.
Well, we really see two different types of users here. The one is the type of user that are really interested in domain, and they don't care in whatever way the information is published, whether it's in HTML or PDF. They just are interested in their domain and not in the publishing form or process. And there's the other type of user that I really want to always investigate the boundaries of how can you publish the results. And the second group we can get on board. We can also get on board and interact in our interaction. The first group is definitely definitely harder to reach. I think that the online promise of the scientific article hasn't yet materialized sufficiently to get the users to really the online environment, the HTML, etc. And they still stick to the PDF because there are still some properties of the PDF that are so interesting and so easy, and the online still has some peculiarities that are less less appealing to many users. I think with the new technologies that are rising, with Flash, with Flex, with all those different successors of PDF, but also with the mobile technologies, the tablets that are coming, that those are all playing a role in moving people over from the PDF, from the standard top left, bottom right experience to really the interactive enriched experiment. So I think it's coming. It's a slow process, but it's definitely coming.
Okay, so a lot more to happen there, I'd say. Okay, I'd like to thank the three speakers. Perhaps you want to join me.